Now that we've learned just a little bit about Kandinsky, I have this really fun project that's really more of a game. For this project, I chose 12 by 18 black construction paper. Now that was just because I saw Kandinsky's work where he had the black backgrounds and the colors really popped off of them, and it inspired me to use the black. However, you should feel free to use any color or size paper that you want. Looking at my worksheet, you may recognize some of these shapes from Kandinsky's work. To play, I'm going to follow the rules on my printout. We will roll our dice a total of 9 times. So we will have the numbers 1 through 9 written on our paper above the corresponding die number. For my first roll, you'll see I got a 3. So marking a number 1 above the die 3 on my worksheet, this tells me something I have to include in my design. If you roll the same number more than once, that's okay. It just means you have to include that more than once in your design. Continue to do this for numbers 1 through 6. Now, after you've marked the first 6 rolls and determined the shapes that you're going to use in your design, you will roll the die 3 more times, marking rolls 7, 8, and 9. You are going to mark these rolls below the die number on the special instruction under each shape. These instructions also must be included in your design. Now that we're done rolling, getting all of our shapes and patterns that we will be required to use as part of our game, we will use the blank space on our worksheet to determine our design. Each student or person is going to interpret the rules and instructions differently. You are problem solving and working out your design. When I teach projects like these in the classroom, I won't give direct answers. My go-to response is, "What do you think it means?" Or, "Does it say you can't?" It boggles the student's mind that there is no right or wrong answer. So I'm not going to tell you what to do with the shapes or the instructions. I am leaving that all open for your interpretation. Don't be afraid to fill in the space and use all of your paper, or even use the edges. In the classroom, I always have at least one student that hates me for a few minutes during this process. And they say, "Just tell me what to do." Well, some students really thrive on following those rules. But that means that those problem-solving neurons in their brain are not getting fired, which is one of the biggest reasons creating art is so important to the students as part of their learning experience. Creative projects like these are even more important for those students. Once you've completed designing your project, double check to be sure you included all of the shapes and instructions that you needed to. Did you follow the instructions correctly? You should be able to justify how you interpreted the instructions and included each role into your artwork. Once you're ready, you can either go straight to copying your design right with the oil pastels onto your paper, or you can use a pencil to lightly draw and put everything in its right place. I am going to use a chalk pencil just so that you can see it a little bit better as I'm laying out my design. Remember, it's okay to erase things in art. It's okay to adjust things, adjust the size, make changes as you go. Artists use erasers and make changes all the time. Keep in mind, oil pastels are not erasable though. Once you start coloring, that's not a good time to change your mind. This is my favorite part, the coloring. Now with oil pastels, you can blend more than one color together, and it really gives your artwork a more painterly effect. The colors are way more vibrant than crayons, and it's really easy to fill in the space because they're really soft and blendable. Notice I'm using an old paintbrush to brush away the flakes and erasure dust. This keeps my hand cleaner, and it helps keep my drawing from smudging. Because oil pastels blend so well, they also smudge really easily. So be careful when using darker colors, and whenever possible, try to use the black last. Now you may notice, I often use a lighter color or even the white to blend the colors on the paper more. It really helps fill in the space nicely and gives us almost that brushstroke look. If your lighter colors or your white get dirty, just wipe them off on an extra paper towel. If you don't clean them, those dirty colors will blend into the other colors that you're using. Notice how I usually color in one direction when I'm filling in a space. Then if I need to, I can go over in the opposite direction, or I can even use little circle motions to kind of help fill in those gaps and really fill in that space. If it takes a while to fill in or complete your artwork, that's more than okay. Artists often spend days, weeks, and sometimes even years completing their masterpieces. Because Kandinsky was so influenced by sounds, I encourage you all to listen to music while you create and see if it makes a difference to you and your mood, and possibly even what colors and images you might use.
Drang sein Bundes. sagen, die deutsches Land so oft aus Osten brach. In fernster Wart ich Weib und Kind ihr beten. Herrgott, bewahr uns vor der Unart. Doch mir des Reiches Haupt muss es geziemen, solch wilder Schmach ein Ende zu erfinden. Als Kampfespreis gewann ich Frieden auf 9 Jahr, wie nützt ich zu des Reiches will. Beschilde Städt und Burgen, die sich bauen, den Hirnern übte ich zum Widerstand.
And here's my finished project, my Kandinsky-inspired creation. Because it's abstract, I want to turn it in all different directions to see which way I like it the best. Then, like all good artists, you want to claim your work by signing it or initialing it.